when wrong is being done to me, anger is not good. But when wrongs are being done to others, anger can be just. When Jesus was being crucified, he showed zero anger. Father, forgive them. But when Jesus saw his sheep getting ripped off in the temple and they were emptying their pockets to fill the coffers of these pagan priests, in effect, he was furious because people were getting gypped off. They were getting ripped off. So all I'm trying to say is when it comes to forgiving people that you don't agree with, what you have to remember is there can be a good time to get angry. There's also a bad time to get angry. But listen, this is the sticky idea. The Bible never talks good about bitterness. Never once. Oh, anger can be righteous, the Bible says, but it never once speaks highly of bitterness. You are tuned in to another episode of Hope Generation. So pumped you've joined us. Today, we're gonna take in the second part of a message that I'm super passionate about that I gave at our Journey of Hope study entitled, How to Forgive. Now, to set the stage for today's episode, I want to share with you a letter we just received about this message, How to Forgive. Greetings, Brother Ben Courson. It seems each Christian may struggle with a particular sin of their own. Mine is unforgiveness. I so desire to completely remove unforgiveness from my life. I've been walking with the Lord for 20 years and I do not love others. This scares me and shames me. I am so broken, bitter, and depressed that once again, I plead with the Lord to help me how to forgive. I have been listening to podcasts for many years, but a few days ago, I found the Hope Generation app. I happened to come across your message on how to forgive. I listened to it repeatedly, taking notes, praying, thanking God for the message. It was the Lord that led me to your message to put into practice the act of forgiveness. Thank you for being the instrument in his glorious hands. And that comes from a viewer in Huntington Beach, California. So let's now enjoy the conclusion of this message, How to Forgive. Love keeps no record of wrongs. Get rid of the ledger. The quickest way to be miserable is to keep a running tally of wrongs that were done to you, wrongs that were done to me. By the way, what do you call an apology when somebody wrongs you? What do you call an apology written in dots and dashes? Remorse code. Now, listen. When I'm talking about forgiveness, I'm not saying be a wuss or a wimp, as they would say when I was a kid. In fact, this is crazy. Jesus said, if somebody slaps you on the right cheek, turn your other to him also. If you were to slap someone on their right cheek, and most people are right-handed, it'd be really awkward. So what he's talking about is a backhand slap, obviously. And a backhand slap in Jewish culture was twice as insulting as hitting with the front of the hand. A backhand slap was in the Jewish hierarchy saying you are a lower caste than me, so you'd backhand somebody. But then if you turn your other cheek, you're saying now you have to hit me as an equal. Listen to this. It's true. In the hierarchy, if you hit the other cheek, you're getting hit as an equal. Listen to this. Jesus said, if somebody takes your garment, I was just studying this week. If somebody takes your cloak, give him your tunic too. Well, that was the clothing that Jews wore, a garment and a tunic. So if you gave your garment and then you gave your tunic too, you were like stripping down in front of the guy. So as you're like stripping down, dun, 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 suddenly your oppressor is gonna wanna stop you. Why? Because in that culture, nakedness was not so much a shame on you. If you were naked, that wasn't a shame on you as much as a shame on the one who observed your nakedness. That's why Genesis, remember Noah was ticked at Ham and he cursed Ham when he hammed it up and said, hey, brothers, look at my dad's nakedness. Who was cursed? Was it Noah or Ham? It was Ham who was cursed for observing the nakedness. So Jews didn't want to be cursed. So they didn't want to behold your nakedness. So when you were giving your tunic too, they might want to think about it. Okay, wait a second. I don't want to observe your nakedness lest I'm cursed. Listen to this. Whoever demands you to go 1 mile, go with him too. always go the extra mile? It's never crowded. When Jesus said that, he was speaking to his Jewish culture. Now, remember, the Jews were an occupied peoples. Israel was inhabited by the Roman military. And Roman law said, listen, that if you demanded a Jew, a subject, to carry your baggage 1 mile, he was forced to do it, but he could not carry the baggage 2 miles. They weren't wanting to be cruel to their subjects, so they said, you can carry my baggage, a Roman soldier could say, this was Roman military law back in the first century, you can carry my baggage for 1 mile. Now, that was very degrading because you're treating a Jew like a mule. You're saying, carry my luggage, we don't have cars, so carry my luggage like a mule, like a pack animal. That was very degrading. But if you said, sir, let me go with you 2 miles, suddenly the Roman soldier would be like, oh, wait a second, I don't want to be seen going with you 2 miles. It's against the law. So the cool thing about that context of turning the other cheek, saying, hit me as an equal, stripping down to give the tunic, do you want to observe my nakedness? Go 2 miles? Are you sure you want to break the law and be seen doing this? Because that was a public thing. The interesting thing is, Jesus was teaching that there is such a thing as dignified love. In other words, love is not just being a doormat. That's not going to work well for you. People can't make you feel inferior without your consent. Like, you can just let people walk over you all the time, but that's not going to go very well. There's a third way. Some people think it's all about aggression. Other people think it's all about being passive and weak. But Jesus taught third way wisdom. Jesus was so wise. He's like, there's a better way to live. You can live with a dignified love. Mahatma Gandhi actually took these teachings to heart. He called it soul power. When he actually went on the salt march and disobeyed the English and turned the other cheek, and they sailed away in their ships because they were tired of oppressing Indians who wouldn't fight back. And yet Gandhi was always like trying to be dignified. Same with Martin Luther King Jr. He stood up for his people, but he did it in a loving way. They called it nonviolent civil disobedience. And they got that teaching from Jesus. And I think that's the way to live. It doesn't mean you're walked on by people. I've seen people who just get walked on, nor does it mean you're always bitter. I've seen people who are bitter, and I've gone both directions. But the truth is, the Lord has called us to third way wisdom, to turning the other cheek, going the extra mile, giving the tunic too. It's third way wisdom, and then you give your oppressor, listen, this is the key, you give your oppressor a chance to be remorseful. You give your oppressor a chance to be better. So it's not just about how awesomely forgiving you are, you're giving him a chance to be better too. You're giving them a chance to say, do you really want to go 2 miles? Do you really want my tunic too? Do you really want to strike me as an equal? And you're then making the other person better. That's what it's about. How cool is that? Is that third way wisdom bomb.com or what? I'm just so pumped about learning this. And then I love this, Jesus goes on to threaten people into forgiveness. Look at what he goes on to say. I'll just sum it up for lack of time. But listen, Jesus right after this tells a parable of a guy who owes his master 10,000 talents. The master forgives him. And then the guy goes and finds his fellow servant who owes him 100 denarii, and he won't forgive him. He grabs him by the cloak at the throat. This was called apagogi in Greek law. He grabbed him by the coat at the throat, threw him into prison. And the overlord, I love saying overlord, heard about this. And he says, didn't I just forgive you 10,000 talents? Why then are you not forgiving your fellow servant 100 denarii? You threw him in prison after I forgave you 10,000 talents. You threw in prison a guy who owes you 100 denarii. Because of this, I'm going to throw you into prison. You're going to be tortured until you pay every last cent. Jesus went on to say, so too the Heavenly Father will do to you if from your heart you do not forgive your brother. Now, Jesus is so nice that he threatens people into forgiveness. Forgive, Jesus is saying. It's like he's putting the fear of God in people to say, forgive. To forgive is to set a prisoner free. Then to discover that the prisoner was you. The real guy who was in prison was not the guy who had 100 denarii who he threw into the dungeon. The real guy who was in prison was the guy who threw the man in the dungeon, and he walked around seemingly in liberty, but then he ended up going to the torturers. To forgive is to set a prisoner free, than to discover the prisoner was you. Nelson Mandela, one of the greatest political figures when it came to love. I mean, he was jailed wrongly for what, 27 years? And all of his buddies wanted to go against the whites because he was suffering unjustly due to apartheid in South Africa. And when he gets out of prison, many of the blacks said, let's fight against the whites. It's an us and them mentality. And Nelson Mandela's like, nope, we are going to be unified as a country. And he truly changed the world. And it takes the bigger person to say, we're not gonna fight back, we're gonna forgive. And life, let me tell you a secret, it's so much better when you're not walking around with bitterness. You know what Nelson Mandela said? To not forgive is like drinking poison yourself and then waiting for your enemy to drop down dead. So imagine if I'm mad at you and I'm like, you're such an idiot, and I drink poison, and I'm like waiting for you to drop down dead, but the poison is killing me. That's what unforgiveness is. When you choose to forgive, it will give you more hope. When you give hope to people, you watch what you reap, you will sow. I'm finding that more and more. When I give hope to people, they want to give hope to me. Jesus said, when you show mercy, you will receive mercy. Now, listen, follow me. This is crazy. When Jesus said, the man owed 10,000 talents, was forgiven, but he wouldn't forgive the guy who had 100 denarii that he owed this man. And so the overlord threw the once forgiven man into prison. This is the crazy thing. That was the most absurd parable. Jesus was using absurdity to fortify and buttress his point. Like, we don't always understand how funny Jesus was. Kids love to be around him for a reason. He was anointed with the oil of gladness, but we don't always get that in our culture. Like, for example, when he said, why do you judge the speck in somebody else's eye if you have a log hanging out of your eye? Like, he was using ancient humor. In this occasion, it's a humorous story, and I'll tell you why. Talents in denarii were monetary units in the ancient world. So we don't really understand that when we read it. Let me give you context. A denarius was one day's wage. The guy owed 100 denarii. A talent was 15 years' wages. The guy owed 10,000 talents. Let me break it down in a picture for you, because I'm a visual learner. Listen. If you were to break down this coinage into small change, this gets nuts. Are you ready to... If you were to break down the 100 denarii debt and the 10,000 talent debt into small change, you could fit the 100 denarii in one pocket. Ever heard the phrase pocket change? Small change? If you were to break down the 100 denarii into small change, you could fit it into one pocket. R.A. Kennedy did the math. He'd crunch the numbers. If you were to break down the 10,000 talent debt that the guy was forgiven into small change, it would require an army of 8,600 men, each carrying a 60-pound sack worth of coins. And if they were spread apart by 1 yard, they would form a line 5 miles long. So when Jesus' listeners are hearing this, they're like chuckling to themselves. Because, listen, this guy owed a debt that would take 8,600 men, each carrying a 60-pound sack, forming a line 5 miles long. That's how much he was forgiven. And he wouldn't forgive pocket change? And what's Jesus' point? He who is forgiven much loves much. When I think of the fact that every wrong thought I've ever had, every word of gossip I've ever spoke, every complaint I've ever made, every bad thing I've ever done, every slight injustice I've ever committed, every errant thought I've ever committed, every idle word I've ever spoken since I was in my mother's womb, every thought that was in my brain, if God forgives every wrong thing I have ever done, that's a big debt to forgive. So whatever anyone else does to me is pocket change in comparison. And Jesus is saying, I know it hurts. 100 denarii was still 100 days' wages. That's like roughly a third or a quarter of your year's salary. That's still solid. But it is pocket change in comparison. Do you see? To how much the debt is that God forgave you and God forgave me. Are you tracking with me? If the band would come up, man, let me talk from my heart. According to Mayo Clinic research, letting go of grudges makes way for happiness, health, and peace. Listen to this. Forgiveness can lead to, this is what research and the data is showing us, Mayo Clinic research, forgiveness can lead to lower blood pressure, stronger immune system, and improved heart health. Do you want to be even physically healthier? Forgive, and you'll free up your body. Now, here's the deal. How much unforgiveness are you carrying around? Is it wallet size? Is it backpack size? Is it suitcase size? Is it wheelbarrow size? And ask yourself, do you really want to be carrying that baggage around with you everywhere you go? When somebody wrongs you, they one-up you. But when you get bitter about the wrong they've done to you and you lock yourself in a prison of your own unforgiveness, they one-up you twice. Then you've made them win twice. I don't want people to win over me twice. When somebody wrongs me, they one-up me. Okay, so I'm gonna forgive them because if I don't, then not only do they one-up me with the wrong they've done to me, but they've one-up me twice when they're now making me live in the prison of my own bitterness while they're out dancing. And here's the truth of the matter. I listened to a Catholic priest say this the other day. This is so powerful. And he's a very, very wise, old, like, sage of scripture. He said this, and I think this is amazing. Listen, anybody who chooses to walk on the Jesus path, anyone who takes the Jesus path will at some point in his or her life go through a major betrayal. When I was 17 years old, I never knew that. I never thought that. I never projected that, and I never imagined that. And there will come a time in your life where you get blindsided. And there are times in our lives where we get so hurt that all we want to do is live in our bitterness, is live in the prison of our unforgiveness, is lick our wounds and always think about what wrongs were done to us. So we're going to build up a ledger, logis esti, keeping a record of the wrongs that were done to us. And it's killing us. To not forgive is to drink the poison and to wait for your enemy to drop down dead. Jesus said, there's a higher way. Turn the other cheek. Give your tunic too. Go the extra mile. What credit do you have if you only love your neighbor? I say to you, love your enemy. What credit do you have if you only do good to those who do good to you? I say, do good to those who hurt you. Jesus said, what credit do you have? What credit do you have if you're only praying for those who love you? Jesus said, pray for those who persecute you. And what Jesus is teaching is the way of hope. This is the journey of hope. And Mayo Clinic research is saying, yes, this is the way to go. Lower blood pressure, stronger immune system, greater heart health. It's the way to go. It's the way to happiness, health, and peace. Jesus was saying that 2,000 years ago. Matthew 5:7, blessed, that means happy, are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy. And what I'm trying to tell you is Jesus, he could have done this. He could have got back at his enemies. He could have got back at the Roman military. He could have got back at the lynch mob. He could have got back at Judas. And Peter wanted to. Peter took out his sword and he chopped off Malchus's ear when he came to arrest Jesus. And Jesus said, Peter, put away your sword. I did not come to destroy. I came to save. I could call down 12 legions of angels. A legion in the Roman military was 6,000 soldiers. Jesus was saying, I could call down 72,000 angels to wipe out everybody. But power is not found in how much aggression you can summon. Power is found in the fact that you can summon aggression and you don't. Power is found when you have the sword, but you lay it down. Any guy can chop off a person's ear with his sword. The power is found in laying down the sword. The power is found in loving your enemy. And then Jesus goes to the cross and he shows that the weak is the new strong. He exposes the myth of redemptive violence. This is all in Hollywood right now. It's the myth of redemptive violence. It's the bad guy hurts me, so I, the hero, hurt the bad guy. He does one up on me, I do one up on him. He hurts me again, so finally I ratata shoot him down. And that's the myth of redemptive violence. And that's how most Hollywood action stories go. It's a myth, it's a lie. Somebody's gotta stop the cycle of violence, and the buck stops here. We say we are not going to give in to this myth that violence is redemptive. We're going to be the kind of people who love our enemies, because if we have faith to move mountains, if we could speak with the tongues of angels, if we had all knowledge and understood all mysteries and gave our gifts to the poor and bestowed all of our money to charity and gave our bodies to be burned, but have not love, it profits us nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love does not envy. Love does not parade itself. Love does not vaunt itself. Love is not puffed up. Love does not behave rudely. Love does not rejoice in iniquity. Love rejoices whenever the truth wins out. Love hopes all things. Love bears all things. Love believes all things. God is love. God's never failed. He's forgiven us 10,000 talents. Let's go forgive the pocket change of others. Can I get an amen to that? If you believe it tonight, would you turn up for the Lord? He's a God of love. He's a God of mercy. He's a God of forgiveness. So let's be like the most quoted verse in the Bible by the Bible, forgiving transgression, iniquity, and sin, and showing mercy to thousands. So spread kindness around like confetti. Come on, man. Everywhere you go, that's how you're known. You're known as a hope dealer. You're known as a loving, kindness fraught person who forgives everybody around you. You are known as his disciple by how well you can show agape charity. Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much that there is freedom in you, that you break chains. Jesus, I think of that passage, I've come to set prisoners free. We pray that you would not only do that physically, but metaphorically when we are in prison, like Matthew 18, that man who wouldn't forgive, that you would free us from ourselves, that we would be freed from ourselves. Because to forgive is to set a prisoner free, than to discover that the prisoner was us. We love you, Lord, because you first loved us, and we love much because we have been forgiven much. In Jesus' name, amen. One of the keys to happiness and hope is a bad memory. Love keeps no record of wrongs. Love covers a multitude of sins. Forget about the wrongs that were done to you in the past, and this will lead to happiness, health, and hope. If you want to watch that episode again, as how to forgive is one of the messages that I'm most passionate about, go visit bencourson.com or even check out our Hope Generation YouTube channel. You can also download our Hope Generation app for free, listen to our Hope Generation podcast, or tune into our National Hope Generation radio program. On our Hope Generation YouTube channel, we have an assortment of mini movies and a playlist of short films that we would love for you to watch and also share on your favorite social media platform. Let's dive in and plumb into the deeps of one of these mini movies now. Cupcakes are muffins that believe in miracles. When you believe in the God of hope, you become too childlike to realize that certain things are impossible, so you do them by accident. Faith occasions miracles. Muffins become cupcakes, persecutors become preachers like Paul, murderous sorcerers become revivalists like Manasseh, and ultimate chickens become ultimate fighters, like Peter, who denied Jesus 3 times when a little girl peer pressured him, only to ask Rome to crucify him upside down. Jesus said, "All things are possible to him who believes." Anything is possible. Contrarily, life without God, it's like a Krispy Kreme donut that's sugar-free. It's not how it was designed. The psalmist understood this. He had a craving for God. In fact, in Psalm 42, verse 1, 2, and 3, he listed mankind's 3 greatest appetites. In verse 1, he said, "My soul pants for God." Error. In verse 2, he said, "My soul thirsts for God." Water. And in verse 3, he said, "My tears have become my meat." Food. Air, water, and food. We can live about 40 days without food. We can live about 3 days without water. We can live about 8 minutes without air, but we cannot live a second without the God of hope. Faith is just an acronym, F-A-I-T-H. Forward all issues to heaven. Whet your appetite for the God of hope. Faith your fears. And mountains will leap into the sea. Muffins will become cupcakes. And disciples who once failed to grasp the upside down kingdom, they'll turn the world right side up. Reach out and connect with us at bencourson.com. Or you can go to our app to see if I'm speaking at a conference, a church service, or an event in your town. When you donate to Hope Generation, you are literally being a part of changing countless lives across the country, sharing not the blues, but the good news of the God of hope. One of the ways to contribute financially is to visit bencourson.com and click the donate button. If texting's your thing, you can text an amount to the number that you see on the screen. Or if you like to go old school, you can mail a check to Hope Generation to the address that you're looking at now. We have a gratitude attitude for all of the giving you've made to make Hope Generation possible, to be the change we want to see in the world. Until next time, Hope Generators, ciao for now.